Today I'm going to work on the encoders. I'll give you an overview of the servo motors that where the encoders mount, and also going to do the cabling to the encoders. So with that, let's get started. Okay, let's start with the Z-axis. This servo motor is probably the easiest one of the bunch to retrofit with a new encoder, because it has a shaft. We'll go ahead and pull it. This is the old one. The old one was a Tamagawa. It was a 1000 line encoder, and we're replacing it with a 2000 line encoder. But the reason why this one was easy to retrofit, so there was a stub. There's a stub right here on the end of the servo motor, as you can see. So this one, I mean, it's right in the open. It's got provisions to mount the encoder. So this one, like I said, was the easiest of the three to do. So the new encoder is a 2000 line encoder, same type. It goes right on the shaft, and it'll get mounted right onto the servo motor. The issue is I ordered the wrong size. When I measured the shaft, I thought I'd come up with 1/4 inch, and it turns out when I got the new encoder, 1/4 inch was a little bit too loose there. So this was actually a 6 millimeter shaft, which I guess makes sense because this is it's a Tamagawa made in Japan. So they may have had this motor special made for their encoders. The next easiest one to work on would be this one. You know, on my machine, I know it's the luck of the draw or whatever, but I ended up with three different servo motors. The Z-axis, as I mentioned in the previous video, had an encoder on it already. But the X and the Y axis, they had tachometers. So what I had to do on those, on these here, is remove the tack, which wasn't very hard to do. You see in the pictures, there was a threaded shaft, take the nut off, and the tack armature came off, and then I measured the shaft itself. And found out that it was exactly 1/2 inch. So I ordered the encoders for the 1/2 inch shaft, and those came in. I've already got them mounted up. And there's a few pictures. Showing a slight modification that I made. The mount was just a little bit off. Of where the original screws were, and I didn't want to re-drill new holes and tap them in these motors, because this plate, I would have had to take the brush plate off the servo, exposing the armature and so forth. So I thought the easiest way was just simply to nip it. Using my Whitney punch. And those are really handy. If you don't have a set, you should get a set. If you can't find the Whitneys, you can find them on Grizzly, the hand punches. Anyway, I just nipped the opening and put a small spacer underneath the plate. And put it back on there, and that just made it really easy. So it worked out well. I added a ground lead. I used insulated connectors. I crimped them firmly. You should always use the proper tools to crimp these sorts of connectors. I went with this connector, figuring this is the easiest way to connectorize the power leads for the servo motors without having to use special tools or pins or that sort of thing. So we added a ground lead. I kind of polarized them so that the female here, is on the positive and the male is on the negative. And so again, this was an easy one to convert. Now the other axis, that would be this booger right here. And let me show you this one. Okay, this one, for whatever reason, is a little bit different than this motor over here. They're both Glenteks. They're both GM 4020s, -39s. And let's see here. Gosh, even this part number is the same. That it's a looks like a 02006301-016. They're both the same part numbers. The model, that was the model number. The part numbers are a little different. So the issue being is that this one here had this cover right here. And it fit over, it fits over the housing like this. And we can get to our leads through that hole. This other one, this one here has a cap. And pull the cap off, easy enough. But as you see, it's recessed. So this one right here was more of a pain. I mean, to get the armature out from the tachometer was easy enough. Unscrew the nut, just like the other one, pull it off. This one actually had a stub for an encoder as well. So this motor could take an armature and a tachometer. But with, you'd have to get a special mounting plate to stand off above the tack. So I decided to just take it off. I'm not going to use the tack. The Centroid all-in-one DC doesn't use tachometer input. It uses strictly encoder input. So I pulled that all off. It has the same mounting as the other motor here. So I just did the same thing. I nipped the inside of the of that mounting plate. And the challenge was with these encoders, you have to, once you've slipped it over the shaft, there's two set screws. Let's see if I've got one I can show you really quick. Well, this one's the same. You can see here that there is a tiny little set screw right here on two sides. Well, these new encoders are the same. So you slip it over the shaft, and once you've got it on the shaft and you've got it mounted up, then you tighten the two set screws and that bears against the shaft. It's kind of a compression fit. You don't want to tighten those until you got it on the shaft. So anyway, so the challenge with this one being recessed inside the housing here is getting to those set screws. So I'll show you some pictures of what I ended up doing. But what I ended up doing is I measured down from the rim here. Actually, I lined up where it was easiest to get to the set screw. You see my little blue marks, my little blue mark right here, and then a blue mark here. Let me crank this up just a little bit. Yeah, my blue marks to kind of line me up. And then what I did is I drilled and I tapped a hole right here for a 1/4-20 set screw. So that I could get in there with the Allen wrench to tighten that encoder against the shaft. So these are Glentek motors, and you know, here's, you know, several different types. So this kind of gives you an idea of what you might be in for. Should you have Glentek motors? If you have another motor, you know, it might be a little bit different. Centroid has some pictures of a servo motor that was refitted with encoders on their website. I'll try and put a link below so you can see that. Your servo motors might be different, how you're going to be mounting your tachometers. Fortunately, I didn't have to drill anything to mount my tacks. I was able to reuse the mounting holes. Maybe you'll have to drill and tap like the photos on the Centroid's website shows, but that plate was removable so that you could drill and tap without dropping shavings into the servo motor itself, which wouldn't be a good thing. So anyway, I've got my my encoders all mounted up on my three servos here. Well, two servos. I'm waiting for the encoder for the Z axis, but that, again, it's the same principle. It slips over, bolt down, and set screw it to the shaft, and you're done with that. Here I've got the same thing. I've got my leads all made up on this, and so same thing. I followed the same pattern. I use female on the red, male on the negative there. Feeds to the servo motor, and I've got a ground lead tied inside to the frame of the motor. So that's all done. These are the leads for the, these are the pigtails that come with the encoder. This is the encoder side. So it plugs into the encoder. That's a nice thing. And then this is the other side that you end up having to either put another connector on here and then connectorize it with your cable that's gonna go back to your control cabinet. Because of the size of this connector here and the opening that I have in the servo motors, all three of them actually, that connector will not go into the servo motor opening here. And since I already have a connector on here, what I'm going to do, I could change this. I was going to use a smaller connector and connectorize this. Let's see if I can get my hands on the connector type. Yeah, here we go. I was going to use this type of a connector. It's a Molex connector. And let's see if you can see that. It's got nine holes in it. So that would have fit down into the opening. All right, I would have been able to get that in there. But what I decided to do, you know, you guys are probably going to be doing, if you do this conversion or do something similar, you know, you may not have the tools that you need to crimp these pins onto your wire. And you definitely want to get the right tool for the pins that you're using. You don't want to, this is encoder feedback. I mean, this data pulses need to get to the controller so that the control knows exactly where that motor is, position is on the machine. So you want to use the right pin and the right tool to crimp the pin to your wire. So I've decided not to use a connector. And the reason being, again, we already have a connector that will plug onto the encoder. This one right here. So we're gonna use that. I'm gonna go ahead and cut this one off and maybe shorten it up a little bit. And then what I'm gonna do is easier, I think, is to solder the wires from the pigtail directly onto the cable going to the all-in-one DC controller. That way, you know, we eliminate a failure point. We don't have a connection on one side of the plug and a connection on the other side of the plug. We're going to go straight through. And because this already has a connector and a plug on the encoder, then it shouldn't be an issue. And we can snake that in through the opening and get it plugged onto the encoder right here on this side right here. So, and I think that's easier actually for you guys. It'll be easier for me is to solder everything when you're right here on the bench, and then once the joint's soldered on each wire, slip a piece of shrink tube over it and then call it good. So that's the plan for this end. Now the other end, the all-in-one DC uses a DB9 connector for the encoder inputs right here. So we are going to have to put a DB9 connector on the end of the cable. Now, I am going to use pins I like to crimp the pins on there and then use the crimp type DB9 connectors so that you can slip the pin in the hole in the connector and it locks in and we're good. I happen to have the tool for it. I have a more pricey tool. It's a ratcheting amp connector for the DB9 pins, but you guys can get from many sources the DB hand crimpers for the pins. And I recommend you do that instead of trying to deal with the solder cup type of affair. And let me grab one of those here if I can. And I'll explain why. The solder type, the solder cups, you know, if you're a good solder hand and you're really good at it, then great. But let's see if I can get you zoomed in a little bit so you can see this thing. There you see the cups. So what you got to do, the way I've done this is I've preheated the pins and I put a dab of solder in each one of the cups. And then I take the tip of my wire, strip back just enough, and put a dab of solder, pre-tin that wire, and then you're able to heat the cup and then put the wire in there and then it'll flow and it'll connect. These are just too much of a pain in the butt, I think, especially for new people. So I do not like the solder cup type DB connectors, and I won't be using them. And you know, if you're a good solder hand and you've done it before, then great, go for it. I prefer the crimp type connectors. These are one of the power pins. So like I was saying, you know, I use the insulated solderless connectors with a full shield on it. Both sides have the shield, so when it go in, there's no exposed metal parts. But this would be the type of connector that's supplied with the cable if you elect not to get the cable that already has, that's pre-connectorized. You can buy them some from Centroid. You can get the encoder cables. They're already connectorized, ready to go. You just have to put these pins on your motor, and you still got to connectorize the motor side if you can't get this big thing through the hole. So you can buy pre-connectorized cables is what I'm saying. Otherwise, here's the Molex pin. And it's let's see if we can see that. There, you can kind of see that there. So it's got, you have to use a certain type of crimper to crimp those. I have it. Let's see if I can grab it really quick. There's the official crimpers for those pins. You've got to crimp the insulation first, then you crimp the, well, that's what I do, is you crimp the conductor, and then you can crimp the insulation. The pins actually grab, are crimped to both. There's two sets of contacts. Well, I'll say contacts, let's call them strain reliefs, if you will. You can see them there. Kind of tough because it's so small. But anyway, the outside grabs the insulation. The inside here is crimped against the copper conductor or your lead. So again, you know, connectorizing cables is my least favorite thing to do. I'm sure it's yours too if you've had frustrations in the past. The other thing about the solder cups, if you leave a whisker, I call a whisker where you got a stray wire that didn't make it into the solder cup and it touches over to the pin next to it. It could create havoc on your install and just drive you nuts. So anyway, we're going to connectorize the DB9, but we're not going to connectorize the other end. We're going to solder it directly to the pigtail. So let me get set up and we'll get back to that part. All right, as luck would have it, my encoder came in today for the Z-axis. So let's go ahead and get it installed. Here's our encoder. some paperwork, a drawing of the encoder. There is some pinouts on the paperwork for the connector. Here's our encoder cable. And a little bag of hardware. Okay, we've got to install the collar, locking collar on the encoder first. I'm going to drop that on there. There she goes. And what you do is you just gently snug the screws on the encoder shaft so it doesn't fall off. Then we've got our mounting screws. Those installed. And then our encoder is slotted right here, so the heads should pop through those slots, and then we just give it a rotate to lock it in. Yep, it's on the shaft really nice. Let's see if we can get the head of the screw through. This one over here, that one's going to jump right in. This one's being a little stubborn. There she goes. This one over here. Well, I thought that would pop right in. There it goes. I'll give it a rotate. Just like that. Snug down these bolts, screws anyway. Get the encoder secured to the servo. That one set down. That's just to get the encoder secured. Give it a little herk. Not a tremendous one, just to make sure things are snug. All right, now what we want to do is we need to get in here and tighten up these screws. I mean, you don't have to really reef on them, but they need to be snug because they bear against that that hub on the encoder, and then you're basically pushing it, compressing the that bronze shaft, the encoder to the motor. And that's it. That's that. So while we're at it, let's go ahead and put our leads on. See how much lead we're going to need. Might as well give ourselves plenty here. All right, and our male is going to go on the negative or the black wire. And our female is going to go on the red. Okay. And then we've got a green ground wire. I made that one male on one side. That should be plenty long. Where's that? Just 1 second and you get a screw to tighten it. We're going to use that right there, that lug. Okay. Secure the ground wire here. And that's it. That's all there is to getting an encoder mounted up on the servo motor. This is a 2000 line encoder. Also purchased from Centroid. It was pretty reasonably priced, actually. So that takes care of that. Now on to taking care of making the encoder cables. Okay, we're going to splice our encoder pigtail onto our encoder cable. I've stripped the jacket off carefully from the encoder pigtail, shortened it up just a little bit. What I did is I used a sharp knife to just score the jacket, not go all the way through, but to score the jacket, and then it allowed me to bend it, and then it just pops through. It'll break at the seam that you created with the score, so that worked well for me. So now what I'm doing is getting a piece of heat shrink back over the encoder cable. Okay. And now what I did is I created a chart that crosses the encoder pigtail to the Centroid encoder cable that I bought. And I'll just go through one step at a time till I get them all completed. Now there are twists in both the pigtail and the encoder cable. And we want to try and maintain those as much as possible. So now I'm going to take care of the encoder cable, do the same thing. I'm going to slightly score the outside jacket. When I get to the tail end, probably the last quarter inch, I'll push a little bit harder to break through. So I've got something to open up. You see, it's just a score right here. And then it'll just, at that weak spot where you scored it, it'll just allow you to peel it back. And then I take my little cutters here and I, without cutting the conductors or the drain wire, I cut back the outer jacket. Okay. And I gotta grab a little piece of heat shrink to put over the outside of this. there's a rip cord in this. If you have to rip a lot of it, you can get back to where you can pull on the rip cord, and then you can peel the jacket off. Because I had so little to take off, I didn't worry about using the rip cord. Okay. Just go ahead and peel the Mylar off of the encoder cable. You can kind of see the twists in the encoder cable here. Okay, get our heat shrink up here. Normally I use a heat gun, but my heat gun is not here. So I'm very carefully using this micro torch to heat up the heat shrink. Moving it back and forth until it's well shrunk without burning the heat shrink. Okay. Now I'm only going to do a few of these conductors because I don't want to bore you. We've got basically 9 splices to make. I take the drain wire, I'll twist it, pull it back, look at my chart. The first wire to do is on the encoder cable, blue to white on this cable. So the encoder cable pigtail is blue, and then we're going to go to white, and I'm working my way down the list. And I'm going to try and maintain the twists in the cable. So here's the two that we're going to work with. First pair, maintain the twist. Got strippers here that I've set for the tension and the amount of insulation that I want to take off. And we said white, so we're going to bolt a white. White. And now we're going to slip a piece of heat shrink over this. I try and get a piece of heat shrink that's loose enough that'll go over it and far enough back so that when you solder this, it doesn't start to close up. If it does close up a little bit, it's a little bit bigger, so we'll be able to get it over the splice. So I give these a twist, and we'll take our solid blue, and I like to give them a splice. It's a little bit harder to do it this way. Some people have extra hands, which is basically a pair of alligator clips and a solid wire that will hold your wires together. But I like to do this first, give them a little twist, make sure they're straight. And I make sure my soldering iron is hot and clean. Tin it a little bit, put a drip of solder on there, and it helps to transfer the solder, and then once it starts to flow, move rather quickly. I lick my fingers and I like to cool it off. And lastly, I'm kind of looking for any little whiskers, any wires that didn't go down. I want to make sure that when I put the heat shrink over it, we don't get one of these wires popping through the heat shrink. Check it real well, cover it up. And a little torch here to work. There we go. And just dance that flame. I'm not touching the heat shrink at all with flame. I'm just trying to get the heat on it. Just enough to shrink it down. Hopefully you saw that. It did shrink down, and that's it. Get another one here on camera for you. Hopefully you can see what's going on. Get another piece of heat shrink ready. So the next wire is blue. Yeah, it was blue with a black, which is this one. And we're going to go with black with a white, which is this one here. So I'm gonna get this thing, the piece of heat shrink threaded on there first. We'll get the wire strip back. Get this wire strip back. Make sure we get a twist back in the cable, our wires. Sometimes you have to fuss with it a little bit doing it this way, but it will work. Whoops, pulled it apart again. Doesn't help to have big fingers. Solder, get an iron, put a dab of solder on there. Make sure we don't have anything sharp sticking up. These needle nose have a flat spot on them. Make sure we got good coverage and heat it up very gingerly. Get the heat to it. Don't want to burn wires, and we don't want to burn the heat shrink. Okay, that's another one, and I'll continue on and I'll show you what we got when we're done. Okay, there's a completed splice. I tried to maintain the twist as much as possible on both cables. Everything's all heat shrunk. All the conductors are heat shrunk. Now what's left is to put our DB9 connectors on the other end of our encoder cable that goes back to the all-in-one DC. So this part of the job is done. One of the things you want to do too, before you get too far along, is make sure you put your, this is the power cable for the servo motor right here. And this is a strain relief that's going to support the cable in the motor. It has a rubber grommet here, and then this will crimp down, clamp down on the cables. But you want to get this all on before you put your DB9 connector on the other end of your cable. So I thought this is worth mentioning. This has bitten me before, where I've made up the other end and then I forgot the strain relief. So make sure you get your strain relief for whatever connector you're going to need on your cable. In this case, because of the way I've done it, I'm using a cord grip strain relief here. So make sure you do this so you don't forget.